So Nirmal Jain of IIFL is joining us, needs no introduction. Mr. Jain, hi, a very warm welcome to the show. So could you talk to us about the Q4 earnings, what worked for you this time and what didn't? Because the environment is not really conducive right now, and we're not going through the best of the times as well as far as the financial services sector is concerned.
Yeah, so I think there have been headwinds for financial services sector, but there are positive trends also. So if you look at our Q4 results, then in our NBFC business, we had a very strong growth. In fact, our loan disbursement, our volumes grew by 7.6% in the quarter, and primarily driven by retail. And the core products that we have in retail are gold loan, small business loans, and home loans. And we saw that there's a good demand and good quality credit is possible in a market when there's, you know, competition has slowed down. At the same time, our wealth business also, I mean, if you remember, then in the last quarter we had rejigged our business model, focusing more on advisory, trying to encourage customers to come on an advisory fee basis rather than just pay for the transactions where there's included amount for advisory. So we are trying to unbundle, focus more on IIFL One kind of products, focus more on annuity-based fee to the customer as well as income to the firm rather than products which give you upfront and when the products are logged in. Now I think, so from that, after that, this quarter has been good, although YOY growth is just 10% in the wealth business for the quarter. But given the fact that we have changed our business model, I think it's very satisfactory. So on a full year basis, if you see our NBFC loan AUM has grown by 29%, excluding commercial vehicle business that we discontinued. So I'm trying to exclude in both for a like-to-like comparison. And that has driven our interest income growth by 30% and profit growth by 36%, excluding exceptional item. We also had a gain on slump sale of our commercial vehicle business. So if I include that, then post-tax profit in NBFC has grown by 55% on a YOY basis. Securities business had a bit of a headwind. So if you look at our full year securities profit, then it has declined by 8%, and the decline was sharper in last quarter. So amongst the three businesses, I think NBFC continues to grow on the back of retail franchise and the retail assets, because 85% of our book is small ticket retail granular book, and that is where we are seeing good demand. Also from a liquidity perspective, that helps because banks are ready buyer for these retail assets. So to generate liquidity on a rolling basis is not very difficult, even when mutual funds are not giving short-term CPs or loan, and banks are also quite reluctant to give you term lending for medium to long-term. So the environment that way is difficult, but in this environment, I think retail NBFCs are well-placed because of, one, the demand side, the story continues because the demand for credit is under-penetrated market. And on the other hand, you can sell down your assets to banks, so it becomes a win-win for banks. These are retail assets and priority sector assets, and so both ways it becomes a win-win proposition. Wealth has actually started growing and in a completely different accounting and business model with more focus on advisory. Security is always cyclical business, so it was a bit of a difficult year last year, but hopefully if the central election outcome is positive and the stability at political and economy level, then we can look at bounce back in securities business as well. In securities, primarily the decline has been more because of lower investment banking fees. FY18 was very good from IPO point of view. IIFL's core strength is equity capital market comprising IPOs and QIPs. And that's where FY19 was a challenging year. But on the whole, if you see year on year, consolidated profit have grown by about 22-23%, which in environment like this is quite satisfactory.
Mr. Jain, help us with a bit more understanding on the asset quality. Last time there was a spike in your NPAs, mainly on the back of the real estate book, and the real estate book stood at about 14% of your portfolio. Now, how does that composition look like? And also help us understand what's been going on in the market with regards to the real estate sector. As a lender, what are you witnessing? Is there stress out there?
Yeah, I think it's a good point, observation and a question. So now, as you know, that NPAs are recognized based on 90 days, and most of the real estate developer financing is a quarterly payment. So even if one quarter payment is delayed, it can, you know, it becomes, you know, it gets recognized as NPA. So last quarter, there was a dual impact. One is there was a huge liquidity squeeze in the wake of IIFL's default in September and October. So the quarter was very difficult. Secondly, you know, government announced sometime in November that they're going to cut the GST rate, but actually it became effective from 1st April. And that basically took, you know, the end user demand, basically most of the home buyers, they deferred their purchases because who's going to pay 12% GST if they're expecting 5% or 1% in some time. And that basically took some of the builders and developers by surprise, and their cash flows were not geared up to meet that kind of challenge. But in the last quarter, we resolved quite a few cases, and now we are back to, I mean, of course, even in as March end, if you look at our GNPA at an aggregate level, we are less than 2%, but our construction book still is at 4.4%. Hopefully, in this quarter, next quarter, we'll get further resolved. Coming to your other question on what is happening in the real estate sector, so my personal view is that the stress is significantly more in the central Mumbai, where there is a huge oversupply, one. Two, the apartment unit value is much higher. It's something like 2 crores, 5 crores, 20 crores. And three, the supporting infrastructure of roads, water, sewage has not kept pace. So it's very difficult to attract the genuine end users, you know, the people who want to live there. So the supply and demand mismatch is huge, with supply outstripping demand in the central Mumbai. But if you exclude that, and if you go to the suburbs of Bombay, or you go to towns like Pune, Bangalore, or smaller cities like Jaipur, Lucknow, all the places where we have our financing, there may be a little bit of slowdown, but it's not as bad. In central Mumbai, prices might have corrected by 20%, and still it looks like that they can correct further. But elsewhere, prices in an affordable segment, the demand is steady, prices are steady. And so when you look at the real estate sector, you can't paint the entire real estate sector with one brush. So if you look at our home loan, our ticket size is about 18 lakh rupees. So we are typically funding homes of unit value of 25 lakh rupees, which is very different from, say, a 25 crore unit value home. To summarize, affordable segment is doing well in real estate. So when we say affordable, it's the suburbs of Bombay like Boisar, Palghar, Thane, or parts of Noida, or places like Pune, Bangalore. But the high price segment, say, primarily in Mumbai and to some extent in Gurgaon, is under stress. But that actually accounts for a very large part of credit of NBFC system or NBFC sector.
We have to speak about the housing finance sector, because that is one sector that has been, in news since last couple of months, ever since IIFL crisis broke out, and after that DHFL came into focus, and a couple of other housing finance companies as well. So basically, what's happening there? A recent credit freeze report said that they might be, and probably some of you and your peers are doing aggressive sell downs. So is that really happening? How much of sell downs have you done? And is there a lot of redemption pressure as well coming in?
So this sell down, I will say, is a very positive and a win-win thing. Because if you look at our entire, so almost about 25% of our book we would have sold down. Out of the 22% is a direct assignment, and just 3% is securitization. So direct assignment is the process where entire risk is also transferred to the buying bank, and that releases your capital. So, your capital is not blocked because, so typically supposing banks are going to fund you at 9%, so you take a portfolio. You go to somebody like CRISIL, they will say the expected loss on this is, say, about 1%. Then they'll buy the portfolio at 10% along with the risk. But it's very positive from the NBFC's point of view, because, okay, you might be paying a 1% higher, but along with that, you basically don't have the risk of losses in future. So in any way, and also your capital is released, so you can continue to grow. And from bank's point of view also, they do the risk assessment, they do the rating, and they are in need of retail assets and priority sector assets. In a way, I think it's a very positive and a long-term relationship, particularly for well-managed retail NBFCs. I think you should look at as a structural way in which NBFCs and banks will cooperate. I don't think, at least as far as IIFL is concerned, that there's any aggressive sell down. Even in last two quarters, if you look at our numbers, then we have raised almost about 4,000 crore of long-term finance by way of refinancing from NHB and other institutions. So, in terms of retail home loan, I think market and the environment and the ecosystem is fairly positive.
Sir, on the overall NBFC sector, what is your understanding? Is the worst behind us, or do you think that the pain can continue for a couple of more quarters to come?
I think this sector, again, as I said, that there are, maybe you can divide the sector in two types of NBFCs, the retail focused and the wholesale ones. So if you have a predominance or a larger part of wholesale assets, then I think whatever we can see today, the liquidity and funding is going to be very tight. So those NBFCs will have to completely recalibrate their model by infusing more capital from equity as well as maybe the bonds or the ECBs or the foreign capital. And in the interim, they might have a relatively higher increase in cost of funding. NBFCs that are more focused on retail will align themselves either by way of selling down, by way of assignment or co-lending with the banks. And liquidity, despite almost about 3 lakh crore of OMR, liquidity is tight because a lot of physical cash is out of the system. And I think the shortfall, just about last week, about 50-60,000 crores, which at April end was more than a lakh crore. There is a liquidity issue in the system for sure. And I'm sure that as soon as, there's a new government in power, the government and RBI will resolve this issue, which is the systemic liquidity shortfall. Because the physical cash either has to come back after elections or things have to sort out. But, my view on the NBFC sector is it depends on the quality of assets and the mix of assets. That how the trajectory for growth and liquidity will be for next 2-3 quarters. So it's going to be difficult for some, relatively less difficult for others, but environment is tough.
All right, Mr. Jain, I can't let you go without one last question on your take on the markets. Do we expect the volatility to continue ahead of the election results, and also because of this global back and forth that's been going on the trade war side?
Yeah, absolutely right. So volatility will continue because what is happening on the China, US is something which is unprecedented. People are trying to analyze how it's going to impact not only US and China, but also the other economies, interest rates and currencies. So it's going to make the markets volatile for sure. But other than that, back home, I think next 2-3 days, people, the market will consolidate in a narrow range unless there are triggers from outside India. We will wait for exit poll on Sunday evening or Monday and the full results on 23rd. Next few days, I think one should stay away from the market, or one would like to stay away from the market and watch, because this time various opinion polls, various media, so it's really uncertain that what's going to happen in elections.
All right, Mr. Jain, thank you so much for your time, and thank you so much for patiently answering all the questions.
Thank you so much.